it's activator.
Oh, Super Bowl activator.
Or explain it, you're the.
It depends on which company. It's not water. It's usually something like methyl ethyl ketone or acetone, and it just increases the evaporation rate, causes the glue to set up faster.
I got a question before we get off the super glue. How do you keep the top from gumming up the chips?
You use a pin.
Yeah.
Some people say you tap it like this and forces the air up out. And
after you're finished with it.
While the cap's off.
Before you put the cap on.
Before you put the cap on.
Yeah, because you want to get that point.
Yeah, you do. Yeah. Exactly.
You shake it down.
Got a point here?
No, I got a question. What's the idea of having the little adapter on the little straw?
On the leg.
Activator.
Oh, it's just, it aims the aerosol.
Isolates it.
You don't want to spray it out. You want to keep it.
Well, all right, I'm going to jump one tip. You can spray CA. Take one of those. You go down to the dollar store and you buy those 75-cent aerosol sprayers and you can spray CA. Now, why would you spray CA? If you're trying to stabilize bark, right? If you've got a large piece of punky wood and all the sanding is just turning it into cheesecake, you know. So to answer your question is I might take that, it's like WD-40 comes with the same thing. When you want to focus your spray, and by the way, I want to focus the spray. I come from Pennsylvania Dutch stock, so I'm a cheap bastard, right? So I really want to, hold on to that stuff as much as I can. But when you take that thing off, you will get a wider spray and you will use it more. But you can spray CA. Yes, sir?
Do you think you might be able to drill a hole in the pump up sprayer and stick a straw in?
You must have CA.
Yeah. You could try.
Yes.
That would focus the accelerator in a smaller sprayer.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Any other questions? CA is an interesting subject.
Jeez.
What's wrong?
You got it on there too tight.
He's got big hands.
Never spanked my kids, but I grabbed by the throat a few times.
You ever turn thin finials? And notice how right at the end they start flexing? There's a solution to that. The Jacobs chuck on a live center. What you do is right when you get to the end, instead of having compression, you turn it just a little bit and you have tension.
This is a great tip.
The finial just a little bit and holds down how much deflection it's going to make.
Yes. Pretend like that's a finial.
Yeah. What I'm doing is instead of compressing it, I'm pulling it just a tiny bit. Might want to have a stop bolt through here, but you don't want to pull it much, just a little.
So using that fundamentally is a steady wrist on the end of that extremely fragile finial. You get it?
Yep. Stole that from Dan Ackerman.
I got to turn off the marks that do.
Absolutely. But it lets you get that middle part where you want it to get scary thin. Unless you get that center part where you want it to get scary thin. Oh, somebody's phone. I recognize that.
All right, this is, are you done with that?
I'm done.
All right, this is kind of first cousin to that. There's a thing that I call Chuck Jaw No Man's Land. You know what I'm talking about? Where you have something and you, it's too big for one set of jaws and too small for the other. Chuck No Man's Land, right? Okay, so what do? This is a piece of a cutting board that we bought down at Goodwill. It's the third time I've mentioned Goodwill tonight. You notice that? And I also mentioned cheap Pennsylvania Dutch bastards, too. All right, this is a piece of a cutting board. You just take this. You fit it in. Now, we're going to imagine we're trying to mount this. It's, it's not the right size because I didn't do it for this. So I turn that so it fits perfectly. Then I cut a little hole in it. Now when I tighten this down, it'll grab onto this. I have minimal marring and I've solved the chuck jaw no man's land.
And it doesn't just solve the chuck jaw no man's land, it also lets you grip something even when you're in this sweet spot with no marring. That's,
you know, earlier one of the two of you was talking about Dick Rappin has a thing, I posted on our Facebook page the other day. He talks about the size of your tenon. And he says, make this as close to being round as you can. And that allows you to hold on to the smallest tenon without marring it. If I were to do this one, I would get 8 sharp points. So that's a good tip. And the other thing that he will do is he will put in a little line there. He'll actually burn a line. And that burning densifies the wood right there. So when he holds it on this little edge that's on most of these jaws, it really holds it firm. So the point is that not only does it give you more secure grip, but it minimizes the marring. Okay?
Okay.
Question, how's the burning?
We'll get to
wire.
It.
Okay.
We'll get to that.
Talking about plastic, most of you know David Schweitzer. This is a handle he makes, and this piece of PVC pipe. He threads it, puts a nice little wood top and bottom, and this is for, you know, the set screws, and then he uses it. But then when he's traveling, he slides this back inside, tightens up the set screws, and then, you know, and pokes something. So it's just a nice little handle that you can make using PVC. Another nice little thing on my lathe, I have a upward, I can turn out, but this one doesn't have it. Oh yeah, it has a wheel here. But I turned a nice wheel, probably, like I said, 20 years ago. This is a nice piece of myrtle. And I keep that on there because it's just nice. It feels good. It feels better than the metal that's here. Yeah, it feels better than this metal. And you can slow it down a little faster to get a little more grip. This one's got a few dents in it because I forgot to tighten the set screw down. Bounced off the floor, but it's got a lot of fond memories.
Hand wheels on mini lathes. Don't grab this and slow it down on your little jet minis. The bearings are preloaded by tension here, and if you're grabbing it and slowing it down, you're going to change that and possibly force you to rebuild the headstock of your jet mini lathe. Don't grab it.
Is this a sad, true story?
It didn't happen to us, but I learned my lesson.
Go ahead.
While they're talking, you need to grab things every once in a while and you don't want to pry the wood. There's all kinds of pliers out there that have rubber jaws or plastic jaws that let me grab something that's round and do a little bit of, there it's loose. Penn State and Harbor Freight.
Okay, you're turning a bowl. This is actually a piece of scrap wood here. This will never be a bowl. It's a piece of a drum. It's got way too many splits in it. But one of the issues you have is, all right, you turn the outside of it. This happens a lot with hollow forms. I do a lot of bowls with bark inclusions. So they are by nature prone to not necessarily explode, although that has happened. But more than likely, a piece of bark will go flying off. So this is a double tip. Two clicks. What are we up to? All right. Shrink wrap around it. I've done the outside. Now I'm going to do the inside. This acts to hold the thing together. And then I'm going to quit for the night. So guess what else it does?
Keeps the moisture in.
Come on. What's that?
Keeps the moisture
in. Keeps it from drying out. So if I do this and I also bag it, It really helps a lot, right? And if that's impractical, go with strapping tape, you know, the fiber strapping tape. You know, I'm not one of the safest guys in the world. I've never been hurt, never had a major accident, but at the same time, I'm willing to take some chances. And but this is one of those, it can't hurt, and it might help. Right?
Harbor free.
See, I go to Goodwill, he goes to Harbor Free.
Oh, you got
it? You're up.
Again, I'm going to plug Dave. It's actually Dave and Tones. This is just some handmade
tools.
These are just some tools that they made out of square stock. And, you know, they had the ability to grind it and weld it and bend it and that kind of stuff. But this is a piece of metal, a pipe, is the handle. I'll just pass one around.
Well, the one in his right hand there, what Tones told me this morning, Tones Briggs, he told me that is the original D-Way tool. That one right there. So if it doesn't come back, you know why. But you know what? It's time. We need a humorous story.
All right. Where's that bag of sand again?
All right.
I hear they make good saps.
All right. I gotta tell a story about the preamble for a story. This is a great woodworking story. I do furniture, and I was doing this huge table. It was out of Spalding Beach. It was too big for my shop. I had to put awnings outside the shop, and it was really unusual. I think I could show you pictures of this if you guys want to come up later. It was 2-inch thick, Spalding Beach, and it was bookbenched, and two of the boards warped. So I had to put a bottle jack in it, and a motorcycle strap, and a pull one in one direction, and the one in the other direction was warped in the other direction. So, I mean, this is an amazing project. And everyone kept coming by going, well, what is this? So I had answered the question so often that my answer basically became rehearsed. And the lady that lived above me and looking down at my shop, she was always afraid I was going to find Jesus and turn my shop into a church or burn the neighborhood down or something, you know. So she comes down, the widow Hardison, and she goes, well, Russell, what's all this wood here for? I said, well, Pat, this is going to be for JB and Rebecca down the street. It's a 9-foot-long, 350-pound, Spalded Beach table with breadboard ends and turntable legs. She goes, well, that sounds mighty expensive, Russell. I said, well, it's about $4,000. No. Because, well, I guess if you have everything in the world you could possibly want, like JB and Rebecca, you can afford to have an expensive table like that down on the beach.
Okay.
It's not as funny the fourth time.
You're lucky.
So I tell that story to my friend Steve Bartacci. He's the board worker I mentioned earlier. He's over in Kirkland. He has it's a home business. He's a pharmacist by trade, but he's in love with wood. So he takes out a little microscope and he can take a sample of a piece of wood and tell you what it is. And you know, he's just an amazing guy. And he says that he's sitting there. I tell him the story. He says, I got one to talk about. And he says that he was in his shop, and this lady pulls up, and she says, my husband is building a stone mantelpiece, but we need a big piece of wood to go on top of it. And Steve says, well, what do you have in mind? She says, well, the rest of the house is done in walnut. Could you find me a big piece of walnut? He goes, oh, that's tough, because you're going to want it 15, 18 inches deep. You're going to want it 6 feet long. It's got to be thick. And walnut is known for having knot holes and bark inclusions and discoloring and stuff. He says, but let me go look. So he goes back. He fumbles around the back of his shop for about 5-10 minutes, comes out, brings out this big piece of wood. He says, look what I found. It's perfect. It's 2 inches thick, 18 inches wide, 6 feet long, and it's not free. And she says, why did you say that? I was going to pay for it. All right.
You finally got it. Don't have the money for vacuum chuck, but you need to reverse molds. Start out with your standard coal jaws. Add some boards to them. You can custom machine this down to match whatever bowl you're turning at the time. It'll grab it quite nicely and allow you to turn the tenon off. This is my wife's favorite way to turn the bowl around and take the tenon off. In fact, I had to sneak it out of her side of the shop tonight.
So, in the booklet, if you go, I think this is going to be on your website or my earlier website, they talk about different ways to help with the fitting with your bowl turning. I turn a lot of burl, a lot of curly maple, and getting a really good clean cut at the end. Yes?
Whatever the microphone is in
yeah,
that box.
Yeah, close the microphone.
The microphone.
Yeah, that's it.
Okay, that's better? Yeah, thanks, Russell. Yeah. So I do a few things that I've learned over the years. I went to a conference up in Vancouver, and a guy was turning these 4 or 5 foot long burls, big diameter burls, and he would use canola oil. And he had a big old mop that you used to put makeup on, the makeup dusting. Use that mop and put the canola oil on, and it really, really helps get a final cut on burl. Really helps a lot. It works pretty good with curly maple and those kinds of things, and it depending on the finish you use, you can usually, it doesn't penetrate too deep. But it really helps making a final cut so you don't have as much sanding to do. Some other woods I'll use just simple water to raise the grain when I sand or even when I'm making a final cut. Just helps a little bit. You turn the water off. You know, you just cut really, really thin. And you can feel the water coming off, and you just start making these progressively slower cuts, or less deep cuts, I'll call it, to get a really nice finish. So you don't have to sand as much. But that's just simple water. And then minerals. Oil works. Some people use alcohol.
Soapy water.
Soapy water. Some people talk about it. I've never used it.
I'll use it when I'm fighting tear out.
Yeah, that's where I'll use the canola oil. And another one, on exotic woods, the other thing that really works well, so you don't have the heat checks, is this came from a guy from England. Gosh, I can't think of his name. But anyway, a wax that's cellulose based. And Craft Supply actually sells some. It comes out of England. But it's cellulose based. And you use it with the sandpaper. And you won't get heat checks. Because that's the biggest problem with exotic woods, making little boxes.
Chris Scott.
Chris Scott. No, this is the older guy. Ray Key. Scott's just a kid. I go way back. And Ray Key was the one that I learned that one from. And anybody knows him, he's the master box maker from 50 years ago. But in any case, it really helps a little wax when you're sanding or a final cut. Okay?
Somebody asked about burning lines, right? Well, I'm going to start this off. Ralph's going to jump in on this. Obviously, bingo, I've got a beautiful line. You guys all do that, right? Now this is store-bought, but...
Guitar wire!
Works great.
Find a guitar friend who plays steel. Take any of his broken strings.
Well, the truth is, I think you can buy new guitar strings for about $3.
Oh, yeah.
So, one of the things here is, again, I normally have a handle on this, is this is a beating tool, which is really a pair of spice. These things make great even spacing, or you want to do lines like that, and you don't want to have to measure it, right? So I'm going to make a whole series. I'm going to put the first groove in the second. I'm going to put the second in the third. Right? And bingo, we've got accurate, perfectly spaced lines. I missed that one slightly, but you get the idea. Right? No, right. So, one of the problems, now I think Rob's got more experience with this than I do. All right, so if you want to burn a line, for example, on the top of a jar, in this case I'm going to use the bottom of this bowl blank. I'm going to burn the line here. Now that's going to normally hold my wire. I can't get a wire in that angle. So what a lot of people use is laminate. Think of that turn your speed up. Right?
Oh, that's not pretty good.
Can you guys see that? You see it? They're cool, huh? Proud.
Where do you get that?
You pretend like you're buying the kitchen.
And you've been up a couple of
sentences. And I want to try this. This is my ID badge from the kids out of county fair. And I think that might work too. No?
Let's go back to holding it between centers for a minute. This is a dead center. Everybody uses dead centers on the tailstock with some wax? No, use it on the Y drive side anytime you're making a handle. You've already drilled the hole. The hole center is right there on the drive center. You've got to cut light, but it works. Another on making small finials. Ever seen a bobbin drive? These are very common in the UK. I had to order this out of Craft Supplies UK, but it's for making lace bobbins. It'll take a 5/7/16 by 7/16 square stock, or slightly smaller, actually down to about a quarter, and it just centers right up.
Nice. You ever packed around a skew or put it in a drawer and found it the wrong way? If you're a photographer, it just makes a nice little protector.
Except those are getting really hard to find.
Yeah, they are. They really are.
Yeah, this is a legal state.
Okay.
They keep their tarragon in it.
Whatever that
is. Okay, good. There you go.
Oregano.
Make a handle with a drill for your pilot holes. Just a handy tool to have handy here doing pilot holes. Particular diameter. Got a pretty sharp point, so it'll start well. Go ahead.
I'm a big fan of Beal polishing. It's probably the best $49.50 I ever spent at the woodworking show. Do you guys have used Beal polishing? So you guys use other. How many people do not polish your stuff? You should. You really should. Beal polishing. You can. It wasn't my intention to get into beal polishing exactly, but it's a three-step thing. A rouge.
White color.
Rouge. This is old metalworking stuff. You know, jewelers would use it.
White diamond is important.
White diamond.
Yeah.
Take it to the brightest. And then a carnauba wax, you can also use beeswax, you can use all sorts of different waxes, and you just work your way up through the grits. I've actually been experimenting with polishing as a precondition to some of my finishes. And I didn't really get into this, but I will saturate it with boiled linseed oil. I'll spin that on with a rag, slow speed, burnish it with wood chips, maybe do that twice. Then I'll polish it with the Beal system. I have a spare, the red Tripoli, the red, because that boiled linseed oil does kind of gum up that pad. But these go in the washing machine, right? So I'll polish it. You know something? What's funny? That's right. If your wife's home, you can't do this. I'm in my kitchen one day a couple of years ago, and the same couple that I made the table for, JB and Rebecca, JB's in the house, and Rebecca walks in, their neighbor walks in, and I'm boiling bowls in one pot and dipping in wax on the other pot. And Rebecca says, "This is why you're single." So anyway, meal polishing is a great system. We'll talk about this at our finishing demo next week. But one of the things is, I mean, this is basically, they have various versions of this. This is basically a Morse taper mandrel. And they sell you three of these. I own five or six. But you know what? You can do other things with it. Carriage bolt and a cotton wheel. I now have a metal polishing wheel. I actually have one of my spare wheels is because I'm a blacker guy, and I'll take Meguiar's medium grit polishing compound. It's a liquid compound, a very light compound that they use in classic cars, and I'll rub that out on the system. The key with all of this is don't let heat build up on that lacquer. But you know, you can go to other lengths. Carriage bolt and a wire wheel. I now have a wire wheel. This is perhaps one of the simplest things and one of the most useful things, because think about it. Right before I polish it, I've just taken it off the lathe, and now I need to flatten the bottom. That's a pretty simple sanding disc, and it's within the scope of work of that stage of the job, the wrap-up. I'm done turning it. I'm done sanding it. Now I'm going to polish it, flatten the bottom, because I've just parted it off the lathe. Cool?
Oh, about 10 years ago, my wife and I are at the woodworking show at the Puyallup Fairgrounds, and the guy is talking about boiling wood, and I get this ding look on my face, and she says, "Not buy pots." So she bought me my own pot.
It is a legal state.
Yeah. Face plates. You're always running out of face plates? Well, Fastimal is your friend. They sell 1x8 nuts, 1¼x8 nuts, put them in a piece of wood. You've got all the face plates you need for just buying some nuts. Trying to size a tenon? Everybody knows this trick, don't they? Use an open-end wrench? I'm afraid of you. Because I don't use these as a real wrench. They're not very good.
Do you have to do something to that wrench, or do you just put it on the way it is?
I just size it. I just use it for size. Okay. I know people who sharpen this edge and cut with it,
okay.
But I don't trust a Harbor Freight tool to do something like that. I'd want a real wrench.
One of the biggest pains on the backside, of course, is changing out your jaws. Right? You're trying to do it this way. You know, the things fall, so forth. And then, if you're really lazy, take an Allen wrench. Right? And you can change your soft jaws faster, and you can also change the jaws themselves. How many guys are already doing this? And all the old guys. No, you're not old.
Yes, I am.
All right.
All the smart guys.
All the smarter guys.
One of the things we forgot to bring is conceptually, you can get a piece of PVC pipe that has the same ID as your OD on your tool post, and you can have it pre-cut to a length so that this is all to the heights you want. And just a little piece of PVC, you can make one out of wood.
I use EMT.
Use metal. Yeah.
A thin wall metal conduit. I have a whole series of them in 16-inch increments.
He's an engineer.
You can tell. Brad was talking about holoforms. Well, when you reach in and you're making a fancy holoform and you're using a set of